Something tells me my life is about to change. Like I'm never going back. And I feel as if nothing will be the same. As if everything goes black. Call me out if it seems like I'm paranoid. Well, it extends beyond the eye. There's so much fear inside. That I would find myself where I began. How high is the chance of running round in circles now and then? Maybe it's all in my mind, but it's about time I read the signs. Oh, it's about time. It's about
I'm just gonna come out and say that Glenwood is really good. If you just came here to see the shiny number at the end, or for some reason you haven't watched it yet, well, here it is. You can leave now. There's a lot to like, from the story to the editing, and all the smaller stuff in between that makes just much more of an impact. But that's not to say that Glenwood doesn't have its fair share of blunders either. Let's get into it, shall we? The first place we should touch on is the story. Glenwood overall has an amazing story. Most episodes contain a conflict that arises and gets solved in later episodes. For example, episodes 17, 18, and 22. Other episodes have conflicts that continue into other seasons, like episode 13 and 23. And there are also some that have conflicts that last an episode long. There are some advantages and disadvantages to doing this. Positively speaking, it gives the viewer more than one central conflict to focus on, giving Glenwood more variety in the story. On the downside, Glenwood feels like its conflicts jump all over the place. Sure, there are slight mentions of some of them, save for the Wolfpack conflict, but were never really big enough to really invest me back into that conflict again, especially since there was already something else more important going on in each episode. I do like that there are small nods to each of these conflicts to remind the audience that the main protagonists are still facing these struggles. I just wish that I was a little bit more done with these smaller moments instead of just small little sequences, and then it goes back to being forgotten again. On another note, the conflicts that are presented in Glenwood are absolutely astounding. Tell me another roleplay that has students morphed into animals, a court case, two people climbing up a huge crane, and an armed robbery. Get out of here. And it's not just because I like the big spectacles, but because of the character growth and story that takes place during these events. You get to know more about the characters and get a deeper look at the world, while also being very entertaining. Especially after those events take place, the characters afterward talk to each other about the event, which leads to even more character development and a deeper audience relationship with the story of Glenwood. I've heard a flimsy argument against these events though, especially the robbery incident, saying that these types of things don't happen in real life or these events aren't realistic. And to that I have to say, how boring of a person are you? Stories do have to be a little bit out there to be interesting. Playing it safe or making things more realistic only makes your stories more predictable and thus more boring to watch. Even then, has there ever been a robbery that was predictable? Yeah, I didn't think so. Speaking about the characters, let's talk about them a bit more. Just like the story of Glenwood, the characters tie it together with a bow. All of the characters have unique personalities, different struggles, and are overall extremely enjoyable characters. From Finn's funniness and obliviousness to Raven's attitude, with a little bit of a soft side. The different personalities each character has attaches the viewer and myself to them, because they aren't just caricatures. What makes it better is when the characters are put against the problem, the amount of depth they have was already amazing. Now when they are put against the problem, another side of their personality show, which makes them feel like actual people with a sense of realness to them. Examples include Raven and her mother's relationship, or Zack when he's faced with competition. Even the side characters have an explosion of personality tied to them, like Mr. Ludwig and his monotone demeanor, or like Zack's mom with her tough love. With all of these different characters with different personalities and struggles, it makes the roleplay feel very interesting to watch. No matter what, everyone is bound to have at least one favorite character. Mine personally is Zack, mostly because of how he dealt with his conflicts, and is the character who learned the most throughout the first season. But your favorite character may be different depending on on what you're looking for in a character, or conflicts you enjoy seeing the most. Suffice to say, there wasn't a single character in this roleplay I outright hated. Not in the, you're the antagonist so I dislike you because you are driving the hero's conflict, but more of the, your character sucks because you're uninteresting to follow, or boring, or any other faults a character might have. But suffice to say, the characters hook you into the world, and the crave for more episodes was almost unbearable. When I was watching this roleplay, I had to split my watch time into multiple days, and it drove me insane. I was excited to see what new conflicts our heroes would go through, interested to see what new information we could get about the school or about the characters. But you know what I wasn't excited for? 4 straight episodes of filler. Episodes 21 through 24 all had nothing but emptiness. Episode 21, they went and screwed around on a beach. Episode 22, they went to the park. Episode 23, they went to a water park. And episode 24, they studied. The last thing you want to do as a writer is bore your audience right before the finale of your roleplay. Fatigue is a strong force, especially when you are on YouTube, where there are plenty of options for other things to watch without even clicking off the page. And you can say that there was something interesting in every one of these episodes. Episode 21 gave foreshadowing on Raven's family life, 22 did more with the conflict between Zack's parents, and 23 there was a conflict with the Wolfgang, and episode 24... yeah, I'm not defending that one. They just studied. The problem there is that you have to wait for the end of the episode just to get to that point. So you have to wait for 10 or so minutes just to get to that point. I have to admit that episode 22 was somewhat entertaining, as there was a secret admirer always giving Zack gifts, and you couldn't tell who they were until the end. But that gets buried underneath them screwing around in the park for over half of the episode. This very much seemed to me that Aviator hired Ash and Slade to make 25 episodes, so when they had nothing left to fill it with, they replaced it with what they could. Even if Aviator didn't do this, the episodes still feel forced, like they had to be made no matter what, which I don't think is the right way to go around doing this, but at the same time, you do have to pick your battles. Do you make extra episodes and run the risk of losing your audience members, or do you make it shorter but not gain the extra views, which is paying for your rent? If you want my take, which you do seeing as you're watching this video, I would recommend making episodes that just have content in it. Don't have the characters go on a 3-day break if nothing interesting is going to happen during those 3 days. Now we've talked a lot about the conflicts our protagonists go through, but what would you say the central conflict is? While it might not be easy to grasp at first, with a sharp eye you start to realize that all the smaller conflicts our characters go through actually connect to the larger idea that this season is trying to tell. Think about it, the armed robbery, the Wolfgang, Zack's parents not accepting his new identity right away, moving and living in a new school, even the romance. With all of these plots and more woven together, tell the true message Glenwood is trying to get across. That growing up isn't easy. Growing up is probably one of the hardest things any high schooler and new adult has to face. There are going to be problems along the way. But the theme I like to think Glenwood has is that you don't have to be afraid of new challenges, because they are bound to happen. That you need to work through these hardships because going through a dark tunnel just to finally see the light at the end is a very satisfying and powerful feeling that giving up just won't give you. I would even like to think that the process of students changing into animals is a very interesting metaphor for puberty. The process of your body changing and how the students aren't quite used to it yet has a pretty close relationship to how regular teens go through puberty, and how it's something you don't have to be afraid of. This hidden message is one of the reasons I like Glenwood so much. Not only is having a theme rare for most Minecraft roleplays to begin with, but this theme is beautiful for most people who are watching Minecraft roleplays because they are going through this right now or are about to. Plus how well it was woven into the story just makes it all the better. How it was purposefully crafted in this story, at least to me, shows that this wasn't some weird accident that happened by chance, but was put into Glenwood with love and care by the writer. There's one more problem I want to get into before we talk about the cinematography. Time. And no, I don't mean the amount of time each episode of the roleplay came out, I'm talking time in universe. Time in the world of Glenwood. Some people like to think that setting applies to location only. This just isn't true. The setting also includes time as well. For example, imagine a story placed in the 1900s era. That is going to be a lot different than the story set in the 2000s era, so on and so forth. After our characters set foot into the new school, and preparing for homecoming, I thought the rest of the roleplay took place in around October-November. Then this happened.
As of this morning, you are all on break for 3 days. When you return, we'll be giving you your study guides for the year exams. So go out and have some fun before the stress hits you. You're dismissed.
This, to me, was a driving car at 60 miles per hour stopping immediately. As someone who watched the roleplay, I was instantly confused. You can say that this isn't a big deal, but if you make someone stop to think about what's going on in your story, ya done goofed. A simple way to fix this would easily just be add dates when each episode takes place on the lower corner of the video, so everyone is on the same page of what day and what time period the roleplay takes place in, just to clear up some confusion. Now time for the flashy camera work, dank editing, and the aesthetic of the world. And for the most part, everything was really done well. I counted a few times where I've seen the black screen of death, and I wish there was just a bit more variety in camera angles used in the scenes with characters talking, since most of them are reverse angle or medium shots. But like I said, most things in this department were done really well. What I did like most about the camera was how the shot was rotated just a bit on some shots, or even the camera itself rotating during the shot, giving it more of an interesting look than just a camera sitting on a tripod type of feel. It looks really good and just adds to the variety of angles the camera can be placed in, especially since the effect is really easy to pull off in editing. It just shows that something very small and a simple touch can have a large effect on your work. Speaking of, the way the mods were used in this roleplay just takes this philosophy a step further. This makes the visual aesthetic of the setting look way more alive instead of kind of bland and uninteresting, and reinforcing how something small can make a big impact. Not to say that everything is perfect, however, in the visual department. I noticed quite a few times in the point of view shots how the health bar sits there the entire time. It makes a shot a complete waste because it brings you back to the Minecraft feel, if you catch my drift. It's just in the way and it just looks ugly. I remember that there was even one time where it wasn't even there. It's like someone remembered to press the F2 button. There are also a few times you may have seen signs across the city to name certain locations. Well, they were mostly copypasta from Google. The only thing I have to say about this is simple. Don't steal stuff from Google. The Overwatch and Steven Universe posters scattered around are a lot more acceptable, mostly since you know where it's originally from, and it's just a nice game of hide and seek for the more critical viewer to find. It's just naming an entire restaurant based off of some copypasta you found online. It's just kind of tacky. Now we're starting to enter nitpick territory, but there was a few times, mostly near the beginning of Glenwood, where there were tiny errors just in general. As stated before, there were a few instances of black screen of death. I've noted one time where you could see extra items in someone else's inventory when they're trying to change items, and what feels to be camera mistakes here and there. Most of these kinks were ironed out mostly after episode 10, which does give the roleplay a nice feel of progression, but was something I thought I might as well point out. Lastly, I want to cover the humor and the use of changing skins. As you can tell by watching some of my other work, you can tell I don't like it when people think I am too stupid to understand actual humor, so they instead pretend their entire audience is just a bunch of 12s who will laugh at random yelling and fart jokes. As you can probably tell by now, Glenwood doesn't do this, not even once. I can't really say it has deep or insightful humor, but I can definitely say that it was funny. The humor is written naturally with all the characters, no jokes feel forced or overdone. It makes it even better with the tiny changes in the skins of Minecraft characters and a cute little sound effect is added. That really drive home this effect. It adds much more than two people having unscripted banter because you can't write someone being slapped or pushed into a vending machine without it all ringing hollow. The changes of the skins really add a lot too, because it drives home whatever joke they are trying to tell. Even in scenes that are trying to be serious, use the sound effect changing skin effect because it really works. It pretty much is the trifecta of making a funny joke in Minecraft, not only because your resources on what you can actually do are limited, but because it makes you stand out above the rest. And that's the vibe I get from Glenwood. It just stands out. To excellently written characters, an overarching theme, the visuals being compelling to look at, and good acting, it all comes together to make a product that comes out to be really, really good. Even though there are a few problems to iron out, which later seasons may have already done, the first season of Glenwood is a strong one and has my full recommendation. Go check it out if you haven't already. It's really that good.